The first scene Pablo Picasso looked upon was Spain. The intensity of Picasso's vision derives from the bright sun and the dark shadows of Spain. It is a country of contrasts, paradox, and beauty where you least expect it. Said of Spain, it makes you feel very badly that you will have to die and never see it again. Picasso must feel the same way. Pablo Picasso was born on the 25th of October, 1881, in Malaga, on the Andalusian coast of southern Spain. Malaga is a tourist center now, but it was a sleepy provincial town then. The family lived in this apartment building looking out on the Plaza de la Merced, a stage on which the life of the town was played outside their windows. Picasso's father, Don José Ruiz Blasco, was an art teacher, museum official, and painter of modest renown. Picasso's boyhood drawing of him caught the air of distinction which had caused his father to be nicknamed the Englishman. Picasso adored his mother, and there is love in this portrait he painted of her in his teens. It was her maiden name, Picasso, that he later took as his own. From the time the boy could walk, his father took him to the bullfights. His first pictures were of the bull ring. He did this before he was 10. Although Picasso has lived in France since 1904, it is his Spanish inheritance which provided the capital on which he is drawn to sustain his art and his life. Sir Roland Penrose is Picasso's old friend and biographer.
There are so many characteristics in him which you would say were Spanish. It's difficult to think of them all. He of course, is at the same time a very passionate character and can be very taciturn, can say very little. There are days when he, like those peasants of Andalusia, hardly speaks at all, and other days when he'll pour out his soul to you. That contrast is something very beautiful in his character, I find.
Picasso's mother said his first words were to ask for a pencil. His talent was soon so marked that his painter father is said to have asked the boy to finish the legs of a pigeon in one of the older man's paintings. Pablo knew all about pigeons. They thronged in the plaza outside. So astonishing was the result that his father spontaneously gave the child his palette and brushes, saying, "I shall never paint again. You paint more beautifully than I." In 1895, Picasso's family moved to the larger and more cosmopolitan city of Barcelona, where his father had been appointed professor of fine arts. Barcelona was altogether a more exciting place than Malaga. Picasso found new inspiration there. At 14, Picasso was too young for the advanced class at the art school, but his father got him the chance to try the entrance examination. He had a month to produce the required drawings. He did them in one day, and the jury, recognizing an authentic prodigy, admitted him at once. The paintings Picasso was doing at 14 and 15 were not a boy's work. They were pictures of remarkable skill and individuality. Already, he was bringing off effects conventional painters wouldn't even try. The hangout for the young bloods of Barcelona was a cafe called El Cuatro Gats, the Four Cats. Picasso was a regular. In spite of his youth, Picasso became the center of a group of poets, artists, and anti-establishment intellectuals. He drew portraits of all his bohemian friends and of himself. He also did a poster for the cafe, very much in the manner of Toulouse-Lautrec. It doubtless paid for some of the meals and drinks. Until he was 17, Picasso had always lived in towns and cities. But in 1898, recovering from an illness, he went to stay with friends in the village of Horta on the River Ebro. For the first time, Picasso was living close to the immemorial, unchanging peasant life of Spain. People who had never known anything but poverty, hard work, and travail. The months he spent there made a lasting impression. With his customary omnivorous curiosity, Picasso took in everything he saw. The humble, durable country folk. He learned the ways of farm animals and the men who tended them. The architecture of Horta falls into natural cubist patterns, square piled upon square, facet against facet. And 10 years later, Picasso returned there to paint some of his first cubist pictures. After Barcelona and Horta, the next great step in Picasso's development was his first visit to Paris in 1900. Picasso has never liked to write letters, preferring to draw. And his letters home were in the form of sketches describing his progress. On the train. Arriving in Paris. Looking at the sights. Paris at the turn of the century was a magnet for every young artist. It was a laboratory where the first great experiments in modern art were taking place. Picasso could see there the works of the new masters at first hand. Cézanne was still alive. Toulouse-Lautrec still had a year to live. Renoir was only 59, Monet a year older. Picasso was lent a studio, even found a dealer who put him on a stipend of a dollar a day. Half the great names who were to revolutionize modern art were starving in Paris then. Matisse, Braque, Rouault. Collectors who had finally accepted the Impressionists were still not ready to invest in the next step forward. It was a great time for new painting, but a hard one for the new painters. In his paintings around this time, you can see Picasso struggling to find his own style. His pictures were often influenced by the work of other painters. He may have been looking at Van Donden. He experimented with the pointillist techniques of Seurat and Signac. But in everything he did, you can see his own handwriting. Picasso was desperately poor. His best friend had died. He feared that for all his talent, he was a failure. Out of this mood of despair emerged the first distinctive, unmistakable Picasso style, the Blue Period. It could hardly be called anything else because the pictures were suffused with somber, melancholy blue to fit his somber, melancholy mood. The blue pictures have been criticized for being overly sentimental, but they struck an immediate chord. People got the message. Even today, they are, for most people, the most readily digestible of Picasso's pictures. He began to find buyers like the great Russian collector Shukin and Morozov, whose collections of early Picassos now hang in Leningrad and Moscow. Gertrude Stein, already celebrated as a poet and writer, began buying too. On her first visit to Picasso's studio, she and her brother Leo bought several paintings for $160. They would probably be worth more than $1 million now, but that was the biggest sale Picasso had ever made until then, and a red-letter day. Gertrude Stein was not only a patron, but a friend. Through her, he met the most important poets, writers, and critics of the day. Picasso insisted on 80 sittings for his portrait of Gertrude Stein, finally did the face from memory. Her friends thought it didn't look like her, but later, she came to look like the portrait. Things began to get better for Picasso. In 1904, he fell in love with and took as his mistress a pretty girl called Fernande Olivier. They were poor, but happy. Appropriately, his palette changed from blue to rose. His painting became fuller, more concerned with the bulk of three-dimensional form, as in this picture of a boy leading a horse, painted in 1905. Around this time, Daniel Henri Kahnweiler became Picasso's principal dealer, as he is today. They have grown old together.
One morning, I went to Montmartre, to the famous place, which has been called afterwards Le Bateau Lavoir, the most dirty, the most poor, incredibly poor. I went there, and I knocked. A young man opened me, quite nude, just with a shirt, legs and arms nude. Took me by the hand and let me enter. And there was, I have often told it, there was a very beautiful woman, which was famous Fernand. There was a very big dog, which was called Fricka. There was a very big painting, which has been called afterwards Les Demoiselles d'Avignon.
With this painting that Kahnweiler saw, Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, Picasso changed the whole course of modern art, breaking decisively with the still dominant tradition of Impressionism. Sir Roland Penrose.
I think one of the things which was most important, perhaps, was his feeling that the Impressionists, their painting was not sufficient. It was a fleeting glimpse of nature, which they translated very beautifully into paint on canvas. It was the eye, as it saw things, which dominated. Picasso wanted something deeper than that, in a way. He wanted a conception to dominate, rather than just a fleeting glimpse of things. He wanted to get deeper into what he knew about things, not only what he saw. The nudes that he painted in 1905, 1906, were beginning to get lumpy, like sculpture. And, of course, that began to pose the question, too, of beauty. What sort of quality you wanted in the painting. Were you just seeking beauty, or were you seeking something which conveyed emotion? And Picasso decided that what he was looking for was something which really provoked and conveyed emotion. In fact, he was looking for some powerful element which was not just beauty.
From the beginning, that powerful element in this picture, which now hangs in New York's Museum of Modern Art, disturbed people. Its awkward, unsymmetrical, uncompromising figures made Matisse first laugh and then grow angry. Even Braque said it made him feel as though someone were swallowing gasoline and spitting out fire. Only the dealer, Kahnweiler, liked it.
I must say, because it's so, I was taken immediately by these pictures, I found that it was something extraordinary. I did not understand why Picasso had done it. I did not understand why it was done that way, but I found it extraordinary. I found it splendid.
We can still see in it what made his contemporaries so angry. In the first place, the picture is not at all harmonious. It's almost in two halves. The three figures on the left are separated from and in sharp contrast to the two on the right, with their contorted bodies and their grotesque faces glowing with the sinister energy of African masks. The severe stylization, the strange colors and the planes and angularities have nothing to do with nature, but they do have everything to do with what followed in art, for they were, in fact, the direct precursors of cubism and a great deal of what we now take for granted as modern art. Yet, perhaps wounded by the criticism, the painting wasn't publicly exhibited for 30 years, and for half that time he kept it hidden, rolled up under his bed. So much for the legend that Picasso was only moved by money or the desire to shock. But if few people saw this painting, the right ones did. And from it, they discovered new ways to create new images, tap deep reservoirs of emotion and summon up spirits from the deep. Les Demoiselles d'Avignon is the great landmark of 20th century painting. After the breakthrough with the distorted figures of the time of Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, what Picasso sought next was a revolutionary way of restructuring an image. It came to be called cubism. It sought to dissect the subject, strip it of non-essentials, take it apart, and then put it back together in a different way without losing the inner reality. It remains Picasso's most revolutionary achievement, according to the English artist and art historian, Michael Ayrton.
I think fundamentally that Picasso's cubist paintings of 1909 to 1912 are perhaps the greatest sort of single achievement that he's ever made. I mean, this will live in history as having changed the way in which a whole generation saw and sees. This is one of the most seminal things that the 20th century has produced.
Picasso had a partner in the invention of cubism, Georges Braque. Braque was as tall and French as Picasso was small and Spanish. But the two arrived at the cubist idea independently and then pursued it in a collaboration that was unique for both. So similar was their manner that some people profess to be unable to tell which cubist painting is a Picasso and which is a Braque. Braque himself provided the key. "Picasso is Spanish, I am French," he said. And the cubist Picassos can be identified by a kind of Spanish gloom and austerity, whereas Braque's more serene and amiable French temperament shines through in his. Although cubism was meant to be cryptic, Picasso even used it for portraits. Michael Ayrton.
I think Picasso is one of the most astonishing portrait painters who's ever lived. And for a very odd reason, you see, I think that the concerted attack that he's made on the human features, which is one of the factors that will be most remembered about him, has always been made without losing the likeness. He'll take a human head right from the cubist period. He will smash it to pieces, like somebody smashing glass with a hammer. He will reassemble it with both eyes on the same side of the head, with the nose on one side, with both ears together, and it will never have lost the absolute likeness of what in other circumstances you might call the sitter. And it seems a ruthless situation, and yet, curiously, he can even get tenderness into it. He can even dislocate a face completely, and it's still not ugly. It's delicate and tender. It's a very strange thing to be able to do.
Picasso himself says his art is essentially autobiographical, and this is nowhere more evident than in his portraits of the numerous women who have played a part in his life. He has lived with many women and fathered their children, but actually he married only two. There was Olga Koklova, the Russian ballet dancer. He did marry her,
They had a son, Paulo. Marie-Thérèse Voltaire, who also gave him a child, Maya. Later, Dora Maar, who lived with Picasso during the turbulent years of the Spanish Civil War and World War II. Françoise Gillot succeeded her and bore Picasso two children, Claude and Paloma. Then came Jacqueline Roque, who is now his wife. They finally married when he was 80. She still presides over their home in the south of France. As his own autobiographer, Picasso himself also regularly appears in his art in a thousand disguises and transformations. Sir Roland Penrose.
There are various characters throughout his work who you have a very strong feeling that he's sharing their personality. Starts with Harlequin, of course, in the early days. The young lover, the strolling player, at the same time the outcast. The man who doesn't quite fit into society, but who is a sort of mercurial, fascinating character.
Visualizing himself as a kind of public entertainer who puts on one face while remaining immersed in his own private world, Picasso often identified with the classical characters of the circus.
Next time there's an actual mythical character who seems to coincide with Picasso himself is in the early 30s when the Minotaur appears, a much more robust and earthy creature, this half-man, half-beast god. He hadn't been in any of Picasso's work before, but Picasso did this series called The Sculptor's Studio, in which the sculptor, a venerable old man with a beard, lies beside his beautiful naked model. Suddenly, in comes the Minotaur, a riotous figure who jumps into bed with the girls, flirts with them, upsets the whole studio atmosphere. There's a wonderful drawing of the old sculptor having woken up then, carousing with the Minotaur and all the girls around. But very soon, things get a bit out of hand, and it finishes up with rape and a state where the Minotaur has got completely out of hand, and follows up too with another wonderful series in which the Minotaur is blinded. First he's, you see him in the arena, like the bull, actually being killed, and there he is dying. And the other series, which was a little bit later, he's blinded. And there he walks with his staff beside the quay, led by a little child. I think it's that sort of earthiness, the passionate, spontaneous side, which he admires in the bull, in the animal, something which we've lost to some degree because we reason and we check ourselves.
Certainly no artist has documented the bullfight more intensively than Picasso. He is moved and fascinated by everything about it. Thank you. Picasso reveled in the bullfight, but the tragedy in the bullring is symbolic. The authentic tragedy of modern Spain, the Civil War in the 1930s, produced an altogether more profound reaction from Picasso that burst out in the great painting of protest, Guernica.
When Picasso painted Guernica, it was a direct answer to the appeal that came from the horrors of the Spanish War, particularly the bombing of the little Basque town of Guernica. It was painted in anger and in agony, that picture. Imagery in the picture that doesn't bring in any particular people or politicians or anybody like that. It's the people in general. It's the women with their children in their arms. It's the broken warrior lying on the ground, and the animals that are important in that picture. The horse, a defiant victim, howling as it dies, and the bull. He's rather the only element which lives through this catastrophe of war. He stands there. One thing which is unmoved, it's a sort of force of nature that goes right through.
After the Spanish Civil War, Picasso loaned Guernica to the Museum of Modern Art in New York, where it still cries its protest. Picasso vowed never to return to Spain while Franco was in power. He remained in France, even during the German occupation in World War II. This was an act of enormous personal courage. His fierce attacks on fascism had made him a natural target for German persecution, but he stayed on and defied them. The Spanish Civil War and World War II dragged Picasso into the world of politics. He joined the Communist Party. He told me after the war that he had seen the French communists in the streets and the French fascists on the rooftop shooting at each other while he was in the middle. "I could not stay in the middle," he told me.
He was extremely brave and loyal to the cause of the resistance. And that swayed him to some degree when they implored him to become a communist. And Picasso's communism is an idealist idea. It's a humanitarian idea, rather than a political idea. He's in no way ever been a political schemer.
he made a magnificent lithograph of his old friend, the pigeon, as a poster for a communist peace congress in Paris. As the most famous artist in the world, Picasso was a great prize for the party. For a while, he let them trot him out all over the place. But he disliked being manipulated, and when they produced him before the cameras at a communist occasion in England, he was hesitant and embarrassed.
Quiet. We're recording.
Right.
Yes. Right. Saturday.
Bon. Bien.
Comment?
Je suis venu en Angleterre pour la deuxième fois.
I am in England, he said, for the second time for the Peace Congress, and I hope for success for this magnificent cause. Nothing politically revolutionary shows in Picasso's art. His big mural in the UNESCO building in Paris, unveiled in 1958, is more admired by non-communists than by communist members of the UN. The great themes of war and peace are what Picasso's politics are about, not party dogma. In these war and peace murals and Valoris, Picasso is saying he's against war and suffering and injustice, and that he's for peace and joy and pretty girls. His politics are as simple as that, which is why the communists distrust him, and why his politically activist period ceased long ago. At the end of World War II, Picasso moved to the south of France, where he has lived and worked ever since. Commanding high prices and painting prodigiously, Picasso in one great house after another. I want to live like a poor man with a lot of money, he once told Kahnweiler. He had a lot of money, and as one house became crammed with his work and accumulations, he would move to another and then repeat the process. The result is that these abandoned dwellings like La Californie are now repositories, treasure houses, full of enough of Picasso's own work and his collections of other masters to furnish half a dozen museums. In Antibes, where Picasso decorated the museum in the old castle, he had set up housekeeping with a new girl, as usual, much younger than he, the beautiful and very independent Françoise Gillot. He was well into his 60s then, but he's always looked younger than his age. For some years, Picasso and Françoise knew much happiness together, and this period produced some of Picasso's gayest and most lighthearted paintings. All fawns, flowers, and shepherds with pipes. They're full of charm, but less substantial and less profound than Picasso's painting a generation earlier. Those years also produced two children, Claude and Paloma. Francoise's son, Claude, being led by his elder brother, Paulo, Olga's son. Picasso has always adored children and his role as father, at least until they grow up. Then he is capable of dismissing them from his life as completely as he has dismissed his former mistresses. Picasso had his own ideas about child rearing, as his son Claude remembers.
Always took me to the bullfights, you know, when I was 2.5 or 3 years old, you know, I mean, and after that, of course, bullfights don't do anything to me anymore, but when I think about it, I must have done something, you know, and all these things, you know, so they were nice, I think, because I was treated as an adult, you know, but that's, I think, Spanish thing, you know, boys, you know, I think I lived Spanish style when I was a kid.
The children were not encouraged to be too solemn about the art which surrounded them.
The casts, you know, have to be patined. Well, the best way to patine a bronze sculpture is to pee on it. So every time we had to pee, my father would scream, go pee on the bronze, you know, go on the goat, on the man with the sheep, you know, and anything, the head of the Ramada or whatever, you know, just go and pee on it.
Picasso's grasp on people is as magnetic as his grasp of imagery. Françoise is the only woman to have broken out of that magnetic field by her own desire and not Picasso's. She is now married to Dr. Jonas Salk and lives and paints in Southern California.
I believe that I've learned especially probably about graphics, you know. I think that Picasso is really a master of black and white. And also the strength of the way he builds space. So I should say that about the vocabulary of painting, I learned a great deal from him, especially from the Cubist period. And little by little also there is a kind of dialogue, you know, between you and a part of the past. And I think that there is a part of the past which has to be written and re-assimilated again and reprojected into the future.
Françoise has tried to assimilate her past with Picasso and is projecting into the future. But there are those in Picasso's circle who can never forgive her for her effrontery in leaving him in the first place and for the frank and unsparing book she later wrote about their life together. When Françoise left him, Picasso was an international celebrity of the first rank, and for a time he vastly enjoyed this role. He liked being at the center of things, indulging his penchant for jokes and horseplay. He soon found a new companion, Jacqueline Roque, who from now on was always to be at his side. Like all Picasso's women, Jacqueline was very beautiful. Unlike some of the others, she asked no more than to devote herself completely to him and his work. After they'd lived together for years, Picasso even began to talk of marrying Jacqueline. And in 1961, he did. Luis Miguel Dominguín, the great Spanish matador, remembers that decision.
And one day he called me and said, I will be married. You must come. And I arrived to Mujer to come and say, well, after the marriage, I say, to push his leg. I say, well, you're very stupid. Why you do it? You always say it's not necessary to marry with anybody, and you married now. Why you do it? Because you are now 75, 76 years old, and she's 35. In 10 years, she's 45, and you are 18, 5, something like that. I say, well, you are right. Well, anyway, in 10 years, I take another one more younger.
Well, as we know, 10 years later, Picasso didn't want to trade in Jacqueline for a younger girl. Indeed, he has become increasingly dependent on her as the years have gone by. William Rubin, chief curator of painting and sculpture at New York's Museum of Modern Art, has just seen a good deal of the Picassos and is impressed with the way their lives are intertwined.
She's wonderful for Picasso because I think she understands him in a remarkable way, and she kind of knows in advance many of the things that he wants and what he wants to do, because all the little issues that he might have to settle personally, she takes care of, but somehow she's on his wavelength, and she knows what to do, and he knows that, and he leaves it to her. So he goes about what he considers is really important, and that's the work.
Even as he grew older, Picasso never ceased to turn his hand to new things. He became interested in ceramics and the techniques of pottery and astonished the conventional craftsmen by breaking all the rules and still producing presentable objects. This was in the town of Valoris, which had fallen on hard times. But Picasso at the potter's wheel there changed all that. Not only are his own ceramic designs of varying quality produced in huge series, but everyone else's pots have benefited too. The fact is, anything by or associated with Picasso has enormous sales appeal and is avidly collected, But the biggest collection of all is in the hands of one man, Pablo Picasso himself. What would happen if Picasso were to die and all his own Picassos were suddenly to come on the market? I asked art dealer Frank Pearls.
There are so many thousands of paintings, of drawings, of watercolors, of sculptures where he lives, and deposits in the other houses that if those things have to be sold, as the French law says, because of the four children, there is some French law that provides for public sales. But oh boy, I don't want to think about that.
The stream of Picasso's production has not dwindled with old age. Themes and styles of his earlier work recur. There is also in Picasso's most recent paintings a kind of rage against the indignities of old age. Anyone who thinks that Pablo Picasso has contentedly resigned himself to growing old gracefully should look at his latest pictures. There is controversy over the quality of Picasso's latest work, but the dealer Kahnweiler has no doubts about that.
I think that his last pictures are the best. They've always been.
Michael Ayrton disagrees.
I do not think that his most recent work is his best. I think that it's a recapitulation of much that he's done before. I think it's self-indulgent. I think it's casual. I think it's the byproduct of the fact that he's been for so long, so far beyond criticism, both in commerce and in the press and in books, that he no longer really minds what anybody thinks about him.
In the last few years, Picasso has increasingly locked himself up against the outside world. He has surrounded his house near Mougins with fences and barbed wire. He seldom goes out now in the big white Lincoln, a gift from an American friend. The gates are barred against unwelcome visitors. When his friends do get through the gate, though, they find Picasso still full of bounce and a tremendous drive for work. When he isn't working, he loves a party as much as ever, and the wild Spanish music of the gypsy guitarist Manitas de Plata.
Que nadie la puedo pintar, la plaza de San Lorenzo. Que nadie la puedo pintar, y hay un pintor que se llamaba Picasso. El mejor pintor del mundo se llamaba Picasso.
All his long life, Picasso has been a prodigious, even a fanatical worker. He's never had time enough, and now there is even less time. He is not finished yet. A painter, Picasso says,
is never finished. There never comes a moment when you can say, I've had done a good day's work and tomorrow is Sunday. You can lay aside a canvas, he says, but you can never say, this is the end.